Okay, how's that? How am I doing? Okay. Okay. There are a lot of expressions of pessimism these days about whether we can save the environment and, of course, thereby ourselves. Some of this pessimism is self-serving, but most of it is quite genuine. People look at trends and they despair, or else go into denial. And those who despair will almost invariably point to one factor above all others, the threat of overpopulation. No matter whether we recycle all our waste, switch entirely to non-polluting energy sources, sponge the skies of CFCs and greenhouse emissions, turn the deserts into gardens, and save the rainforests and, oh yes, the poor whales too, all these gains will be washed away, these people say, by the surging tide of hungry hominids. My topic today, therefore, is the population boom. I want to consider the following question. Is it inevitable that humanity must overwhelm itself? And I shall argue that the answer is a firm no, that while it is possible, and maybe even probable, that this catastrophe will happen, it is not inevitable. First, let's take a clear-eyed look at some worrisome numbers so that no one can say we're ignoring the facts. Very soon, probably sometime this coming summer, according to United Nations figures, the world population clock will click over the 6 billion mark. I myself remember when it passed 3 billion. That was back around the time when bell-bottoms and long sideburns were in fashion, not that long ago, really. We are currently adding nearly 90 million new hungry mouths every year, roughly three Canadas. Try to imagine the consequences if 90 million immigrants showed up at our borders in 1 year. In fact, the rate of increase has slowed a little down a little bit since the 60s and early 70s. Demographic experts are now desperately trying to project on the basis of current trends, but the best they can do is guess that world population will level out around 10 billion or so, roughly 50 years from now. Will we all breathe a sigh of relief at that point, convinced that we have dodged the bullet? Well, the problem is, of course, that it is not clear that we can continue much longer to provide even for the present world population, let alone a few billions more, given our current highly wasteful methods of land use and resource extraction. Here are a few typically depressing facts. Since 1960, an area equivalent to about one-third of all current cropland has been abandoned due to soil erosion and degradation. Fisheries around the world are collapsing as we strip mine protein from the sea. Our petroleum reserves, which have fueled our current population boom, just have to run out sooner rather than later. And there is evidence that humans already use or inadvertently squander 40% of the total biomass produced annually by photosynthesis in the Earth's biosphere. How can we go on like this? Faced with such sobering trends, many people recall the dismal predictions of the Reverend Thomas Malthus. Back in 1798, Malthus published his Essay on the Principle of Population, which argued that humanity is inevitably doomed to misery, that is, war, famine, poverty, and disease, because of overpopulation. I believe that Malthus was wrong for reasons that are very instructive, but anyone could easily be excused for thinking that he was right. There certainly have been Malthusian crises in history. That's the term ecologists use when the population of some species grows so rapidly as to overwhelm the capacity of an ecosystem to support it. So what I'm trying to do, in other words, is concede as many points to my opponents to begin with before I get my few blows in. The classic example is the tragic story of Easter Island. This lush semi-tropical paradise, only a total of 64 square miles in area, was invaded by Polynesian peoples around 400 AD. Contrary to the supermarket tabloids, the giant statues on Easter were not erected by extraterrestrial beings. Sorry to disappoint you. Their population expanded over a period of about 1,000 years, from probably a few hundreds, to as many as 20,000, and then suddenly crashed back to a couple of thousand or so. The island was denuded of almost all the plant life and game that had made it such a good place for people to live. The Easter Islanders simply ate themselves out of house and home, and in the process crippled the very ability of their island's ecosystem to regenerate itself. Many, following Malthus, will argue that nothing can prevent Earth as a whole from suffering the fate of Easter Island. The only difference, they say, is that doom will take longer to arrive because Earth is larger. Are they right? Here's the real question. Granted that Malthusian crises can happen to human populations, must they happen? Are they inevitable, like death and taxes, or are they merely something like traffic accidents that can be prevented with sufficient care and foresight? In other words, the issue is inevitability. It's very helpful to look at what Malthus actually said in his famous paper, which many scholars will say has never been refuted. His flawed and, as we shall see, disingenuous argument, that means dishonest argument, is prototypical of all arguments that say we are doomed because of overpopulation. It's a nice way of saying dishonest, isn't it? Malthus begins by insisting that he will eschew all wishful thinking about what people might be able to do. If only they were different sorts of beings than what they really are. Let's look at the hard biological and mathematical facts, says Malthus. Let's stop kidding ourselves. We must accept two facts about people, he tells us. First, the passion between the sexes, his phrase, is necessary, although he does not say in exactly what sense, but is very unlikely to diminish. And we must eat to survive. Second point, we must eat to survive. Well, I don't wish to argue about that. Because of our irresistible urge to procreate, our population will always tend to increase geometrically, that is, by compound interest, even though our means of subsistence can do more than increase arithmetically, that is, by simple interest. These are the terms he used. Malthus offers no proof whatsoever for these mathematical assertions, which are really just conjectures. It is well known that populations of humans and many other species can increase geometrically, or exponentially, as we now say, given a permissive enough environment. However, increases in resource production or extraction can certainly be better than arithmetical, at least for a while. For humans, the main factor that makes this possible is technological ingenuity. Nevertheless, no matter how ingenious people may be, it is certainly possible for resource production to simply fail to keep up with population. There is no question that population growth can outstrip the capacity of an environment to support it. But again, please note my careful choice of words. The issue here is to distinguish between what can be the case and what must be the case. Malthus insisted that it is a general law of biology that this must always happen. All organisms, he stated, must be subject to endless, agonizing cycles of boom and bust, and humans are no exception. The real flaw in the argument of Malthus is that he made an elementary error in biology. One need not have a PhD in ecology to see the point. Indeed, a little common sense shows that Malthus could not possibly have been right, or not exactly right. If populations always explode out of check, the entire global biosphere would have simply eaten itself some billions of years ago. But this has not happened. Instead, throughout nature, we see intricate webs of interdependencies in which organisms, by a bewildering variety of mechanisms, moderate their tendencies to exploit their environments and each other, and cooperate to maintain the healthy functioning of their environments. Biologists call this process mutualism, and there is ever-increasing recognition that it is a centrally important factor in how ecosystems work and even in the way evolution occurs. Now, one can get into some interesting philosophical disputations about why mutualism occurs. But whether organisms are mutualistic out of altruism, enlightened self-interest, or simply the blind urge to survive, whether they are driven by selfish genes or some mystical urge towards self-transcendence is entirely beside the point. The point is that this is what genuinely happens in the real biological world. Darwin was quite right that the fittest survive, but fitness includes the ability to cooperate as well as the ability to compete. Indeed, it's interesting to note that Darwin and Wallace themselves had read Malthus and got the idea of the struggle of existence from him. It may well be that the distorted overemphasis on competition in Darwin's view of evolution may stem from his insufficiently critical reading of Malthus. The crucial point, though, is that what Malthus took to be the normal population dynamic, this sort of explosion and overwhelming situation, is a pathological phase that occurs when a novel organism invades an ecosystem or host that has not evolved defenses against it. This happens often enough in nature. An obvious example would be a viral or bacterial infection run rampant. But it could not be happening all the time, or life on Earth would simply be impossible. What very often happens instead is that an invader nearly wipes out a susceptible host, or else the host nearly wipes out the invader with its defenses, but then the host and invader somehow settle down into a phase of mutual accommodation. Indeed, it is not unusual for the former antagonists to actually become, after some generations, necessary for each other's existence. Pathology evolving into mutualism. This is a very common pattern in nature. There's a fascinating example in cell biology of this process in which a cell biologist had a culture dish with some amoeba in it, and the amoeba were attacked by accident. He didn't mean this to happen, by some bacteria, which almost totally wiped out the amoeba. And this person had the sense to sort of, instead of just sort of washing it down the drain, to keep an eye on what was going to happen in this culture tray. So he just supplied nutrients to the tray and just sort of watched it. And apparently it took about 10 years. But what happened after some time is, first of all, that the invading bacteria nearly annihilate the amoeba that are in the dish. And then they kind of settle down and they work something out. And after about 10 years of this process, what you have is a nice healthy culture of amoeba living in this culture tray, except that they have an obligate, what they technically known as an obligate endosymbiote within them. In other words, the bacteria have become actually part of the amoeba, and they are living in a totally mutualistic state, actually an obligate mutualism. And that's a fascinating example of this type of process. A number of ecologists have suggested that the human eruption could follow this pattern. Modern Homo sapiens appears to have branched off, that means man the wise, by the way, let us not forget. Modern Homo sapiens appears to have branched off only about 100,000 years ago from earlier, less aggressive hominids. Ecologically, we are newcomers like a mutant virus, and we possess weapons, language, and technology that give us an unprecedented ability to overcome the resistance of our host ecosystem to our depredations. However, it is not unreasonable to hope that despite the uniqueness of the human situation, we could follow the fairly common path of a pathological outbreak blossoming into a mutualism. Right now, it is not the sheer numbers of people or even the human population density as such that most threatens the integrity of our supporting ecosystem. Very small human populations have sometimes done huge ecological destruction. Only a few thousand settlers, for instance, nearly wiped out the North American bison. It is our failure to live in a mutualistic fashion that is the real cause of all the bad things that flow from the population boom: pollution, exhaustion of resources, and the ever-present threats of war, famine, and disease. Now, please note, I'm not trying to say that there is no limit to the number of people the Earth could support. There have been some people who've said things like that, such as Julian Simon. I think these claims are silly and irresponsible. What I'm trying to say is that numbers are not the only issue, that we shouldn't just be frightened by large numbers with a fair number of digits after them. It's not just how many of us there are, but what we do that is the crucial issue. Now, just pointing all of this out does not solve the problem. We still have to learn how to be mutualistic with the global biosphere, and this will not be a simple task. But the first step towards solving the problem is to identify it correctly. Now, Malthus, writing 200 years ago, could perhaps be excused for his ignorance of some basic facts of ecology that have only become clear since his time. But a closer reading of his essay shows that he really had something else in mind all along. Malthus goes on to explain that among humans, the inevitable consequences of the struggle for existence are, quote, vice and misery. By misery, again, he meant warfare, starvation, poverty, disease, and ignorance. Vice, he says, is a highly probable consequence. Vice is a highly probable consequence, I'm quoting Malthus now, and we therefore see it abundantly prevail, but it ought not perhaps to be called an absolutely necessary consequence. The ordeal of virtue is to resist all temptation to evil. Let me repeat that. The ordeal of virtue, says Malthus, is to resist all temptation to evil. Does this sound familiar? The final bizarre statement is the giveaway, for it appears that what Malthus actually meant by vice, although he could not bring himself to write it in plain English, was birth control. Not only did the Reverend Malthus get his biology wrong, but he was so utterly lacking in compassion for humanity that he really believed that endless war, pestilence, and starvation would be preferable to the vile indulgence in sexuality for any other purpose than procreation. In other words, Malthus was not really saying that it is biologically impossible for humanity to control its population growth. He was saying that it would hardly be surprising if we might, in our weakness, attempt to control reproduction in spite of the passion between the sexes, but that we should not. In the end, the argument of Malthus falls to pieces. He ultimately concedes that people, unlike the beasts of the field, might well be capable of modifying their reproductive behavior on the basis of intelligent foresight. However, despite his pretension to be delivering a dispassionate diagnosis based on simple biological and mathematical facts, his real purpose is to issue a moral exhortation. It is to remind us that we are put on this earth to suffer, except, of course, for a few especially favored members of the social class to which he happened to belong. In fact, Malthus was writing in the context of debates over the poor laws, the social welfare net such as it was in Great Britain in the 1790s. The debate was hauntingly familiar. Should we help the poor, which of course would cost money, heaven forbid, or leave them to their own pathetic devices? And Malthus's purpose was to set forth an argument that is all too familiar as well. Don't bother trying to help the poor. Their suffering is inevitable, and we would only prolong their agony and perhaps weaken the species if we tried to alleviate it. Here is a pseudo-scientific argument that would be dear to the heart of Mike Harris or Newt Gingrich. Okay. A biological determinism with a vindictive spin that relishes the misery of those who would be tempted to vice. I'll conclude with a little mathematical puzzle. What demographic variable would you guess is best correlated with low birth rates and low infant mortality in many, many countries around the world? I'm putting this question to the audience. I bet somebody here knows the answer to this. Thank you. That's right. Good. They made it easy. I was going to say gross national product, per capita income. Those are the things that usually come to people's minds. In fact, indicators of economic well-being do correlate fairly well with low birth rates. But according to many United Nations statistics, the best predictor for low birth rates and low infant mortality is women's literacy. No doubt the shade of Reverend Malthus is, and more broadly, women's empowerment, but literacy specifically. No doubt the shade of the Reverend Malthus is clucking in disapproval over this shocking fact. But it seems that when women have the opportunity to inform themselves about birth control, basic hygiene, nutrition, and infant care, they oddly tend to prefer small, healthy, well-fed families in which most children survive to maturity than large, unhealthy, starving families in which only a few survive to maturity. Such is the disdain for virtue into which we have fallen in these late times. Hope I'm not offending. Well, anyway, I hope I am offending somebody. All right, let me go on. The point is that if we choose to behave intelligently, and I include investing every nickel that we can into expanding basic literacy as a good part of behaving intelligently, there is absolutely no reason why humanity cannot avoid the fate specified for us by the gloomy Reverend Malthus. If we do not, it is fundamentally because we choose not to, or can't be bothered to, or can't figure out how to in time, not because it is biologically impossible. In recent years, astronomers have been listening for signs of intelligent life on other worlds. I think that these efforts are very interesting and should continue. But the real question is whether there is intelligent life on Earth. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
I forgot to mention, would you each leave $6 on your table? And I think George is here. This does not include the speaker, and it includes the cost of the meal as well as the meeting. I'd like to begin the next part of this program of the Southern Alberta Council on Public Affairs. The topic we're discussing today is it utterly hopeless to do anything about the environment, and our speaker is Dr. Kent Peacock. There's just a few little announcements that I'd like to make. This program, for those of you who would like to see it again, will be shown this afternoon at 3:30 p.m., tomorrow at 9:30 p.m., Saturday at 3:30 a.m., and Monday at 9:30. That's for the insomniacs, and Monday at 9:30 p.m. Our speaker next week will be just Dave Morris of the Canadian Labour Congress, who will be speaking on Left Out in the Cold. He'll be speaking about the issues related to employment insurance, and you may very well be aware of some of the changes. The moderator is Karen Neufeld. And in relation to today's program, Dr. Peacock's book is called Living with the Earth, and I'm going to put a phone call into Maccabees and ask them to bring in some copies if anybody is interested in pursuing this further. So welcome back, and welcome back to Dr. Peacock.
Well, thanks, and thanks for the resources that I've just consumed, which were very pleasant, and I guess my job is to take questions, and do you want to?
Yes, go ahead.
No, I'll just...
I just make a little announcement.
Well, sure.
Just make sure that you give your name and make as brief a comment as you can along with a question.
My brief comment is I think you're a little bit hard on Malthus considering the times he lived in and his church superiors mightn't have welcomed too much on birth control, analogous to the incumbent in Rome at present. Could you comment on the AIDS in Africa? That's some areas it's 30 or 40% taking over. And the other thing is we've had 50 years of foreign aid, and the figure I've seen that only 2% of that was directed to family planning. Could we have saved ourselves a good deal of distress, street kids in Brazil and Calcutta and all these things, if we'd devoted more of a percentage to family planning?
Okay, thanks. Well, three questions. First of all, very briefly, yes, I have been a bit rough on Reverend Malthus. He probably should get some credit for being among the first people to simply draw attention to population as an issue. And, you know, that's a point, too. But I think that there's quite a lot of careless thinking that's gone on. People just sort of bow to this very authoritative-sounding argument without ever actually digging it out, looking at it, and see what it really says. I mean, this is what I do for a living, and is digging dusty old arguments out and seeing what they really say. And it's worthwhile doing that. Now, as to AIDS and other diseases like this, I think that probably one could say that if we do not moderate our birth rates by ourselves, by some mutually agreeable and intelligent way, then our population will undoubtedly be moderated somehow by many of the nature's traditional means of moderating it, namely disease, famine, and warfare. And yes, AIDS right now is a terrible threat. Obviously the danger with AIDS is if it ever became airborne, the overpopulation problem of the earth would be solved in a couple of years pretty quickly, and we wouldn't be having this discussion. But I'm quite shocked at the small amount of money that's gone into research for an AIDS vaccine. It's quite disgraceful. They've put a lot of money into developing temporary cures or things that'll enable a person to live successfully with AIDS, and that's great, but the research should be really going into vaccination before the darn thing mutates, because the HIV virus is a highly mutagenic virus that is quite capable, I would think, of becoming airborne without being very much less lethal than it is now. And if that ever happened, as I say, there's nothing to talk about. Of course, the real issue, if you want to talk diseases, and I'm not an expert on this, but if you want to talk the danger of diseases, the real thing to worry about still is influenza. Influenza still killed far, far more people than AIDS or many of these other exotic viruses have. And influenza, again, we are still not completely adept at anticipating new outbreaks of a new mutant form of flu viruses. And, you know, if you wanted to say, is there going to be some disease that could significantly put a notch in the human population curve in the next few years, it's far more likely, I would think, to be influenza than HIV, not with all due respect for those people who suffer from that disorder. Now, in terms of the whether or not we should spend more foreign aid and so forth on family planning, I'd say sure, yes, absolutely. But I'd also like to see that coupled with just greater increases in pushing for general literacy.
Okay. You raised the question of whether or not humans can become mutualistic with their environment to the collective benefit of both. You also mentioned that in some respects it's not how many of us there are, but what we do, and by that I know you mean how much we consume of resources and so on.
Well, it's not even so much a question of how much we consume, as almost how we consume them. And in other words, if you do something that, for example, if you sort of wipe something out in the process of harvesting it, then it's that kind of practice that obviously is going to be highly self-limiting, to put it politely.
Well, the reason I was the question I had was this: if it's good for us to become mutualistic with our environment, and if we look around at what we do and how we do it today, the relationship could be much more accurately described as parasitic rather than mutualistic.
That's correct. Yeah, I've argued that. Yeah.
I'm wondering whether or not you were talking about the case of the amoeba and bacteria developing a mutualistic relationship. Cases where parasitic relationships can become mutualistic.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if that's possible for humans, but I think it must represent, if it is, it must represent really turning around the way we do things 180 degrees in a whole lot of respects. Would you comment on that?
Well, yeah, it certainly would involve a big turnaround, and I'll get to the specifics in a second. My main purpose was to indicate this as a general possibility. Again, the issue was Malthus says certain things are inevitable. In other words, to put it into the language you were just using, Malthus is saying human parasitism, if you want to define it that way, is inevitable. And what I'm saying is, well, not necessarily, because there are encouraging precedents within the biological world that show that sometimes, certainly not always, but sometimes, parasitical outbreaks, if you like, can sort of turn into symbiotic or mutualistic situations. Again, no inevitability about that either. I mean, there's very few hard and fast rules in biology, except perhaps that there are no hard and fast rules. Now, in terms of exactly how it's going to happen for human beings, I don't have a recipe. I think I can point to some specific examples that are encouraging, certain kinds of agricultural practices, for example, in which, as practice, for example, the way the old field country system in Great Britain used to be run before it was obliterated by agribusiness. Here was a situation in which you had a sort of a horticultural scale or a horticultural intensity of cultivation of the land, with the sort of very small fields with thick hedgerows between them, extremely high biodiversity, birds, small animals, orchids, and so forth. I mean, it used to be that the way you got orchids in Surrey or someplace, that was that you went for a walk, you know, on the right, if it's the right time of year, and sort of picked them, because there'd be a couple of hundred varieties growing within a mile of your house. That's, I understand, not really the case anymore. But there have been examples of agricultural systems in which what human beings have done is, of course, what they're trying to do is simply grow enough food and materials, the food and materials that they need, but you do it in a way that enhances the ecological intensity and the biological vitality of the system that's supporting you. And it generally involves very mixed farming, a very high level of biodiversity. Forget about monoculture, that's generally very destructive. And these systems, there's two or three historical examples. Another example is the Caipo Indians in the Brazilian, certain regions of the Brazilian rainforest. The human manipulation of the ecosystem has actually increased biodiversity, has actually increased the overall biomass and intensity of the ecosystem. At least there's fairly good evidence for that. I'm sure that one can quibble about the details. So I regard these as hopeful examples. They don't solve the whole problem, clearly, but they suggest to me that certain kinds of human manipulation, very sensitive and skillful manipulation of the land, can actually lead to an enhancement of the vitality of the land, thereby providing a sort of a sustainable basis for the human occupation of the land. I just brought along, there's a very nice statement by a very noted ecologist, Eugene Odom, who's been raising this point for many years now. And the way Odom put it is the following. He said, "If understanding of ecological systems and moral responsibility among mankind can keep pace with man's power to effect changes, the present-day concept of unlimited exploitation of resources will give way to the following: unlimited ingenuity in perpetuating a cyclic abundance of resources." And it seems to me that's the general pattern that we want to aim at. Now, when you get down to specifics, exactly how do we apply that to the prairies of Alberta, the forests of northern Ontario, etc., I don't have the answers to all those things. Not everybody does. There's a whole lot of homework that has to be done to make this thing work. But there are, I think, very, very encouraging precedents in human history.
Okay. Tracy Anderson, thank you for your discussion. You raised a question in my mind that I'd like to bring forward, and this begins the question whether you've had a chance to study NAFTA or not. There's an article in the Globe and Mail 2 days ago outlining the attempts by multinational firms to go to Ottawa and grab money on the basis of the laws in NAFTA because they're not following through on their commitments. In the bottom of that was a statement which I thought should be read. The risk of lawsuits has promoted Marchi, who is a trade minister, to request NAFTA partners to add clarification to the laws and rules in NAFTA on environment. They want clarification that this risk of law going into Ottawa and grabbing money won't be used to strike down reasonable environmental regulations. Now, whether he'll get it through or not, I don't know, but that's an illustration of one of the reasons, one of the ways we're going toward some of the things you've mentioned. Would you comment, please?
Well, interesting question. It raises a lot of issues, some of which I don't know as much about as I'd like to. I think everybody has very strong concerns about multinational corporations and this international corporatism sort of dominating virtually all agendas across the board. And regardless of whatever good intentions may be mouthed, you have a system of international agreements coming into place which seem to make business profitability the only effective issue. And things like preservation of the environment is seen as, well, as the chief economist, Lawrence Summers, chief economist of the World Bank, put it a few years ago, the environment becomes, quote, a tradable good, unquote. It's just one amongst many consumer items which may or may not be supported by the marketplace. And I think that's an extremely dangerous precedent. What it simply does is sort of institutionalize this parasitical trend that we've been talking about. I'm pretty worried about the MAI, for example, Multilateral Agreement on Investment. Now, I understand that is temporarily dead, but that's sort of like saying Dracula is temporarily dead during the daytime. You know, under the MAI, if I'm not mistaken, there are actually provisions which would essentially make it impossible, for example, for Lethbridge, to take an example, to effectively enforce various environmental regulations. Imagine that the town of Lethbridge brought in rules mandating the air quality or water quality or something like that. Some company could come here from some that was signatory to the treaty and could say, well, you know, that's interfering with the profitability of our investment here. And they would actually be able to go to court and strike down the enforcement of a local law. It's not that you wouldn't be allowed to make any laws you want, but that was just only be to make you feel good. You wouldn't actually be able to enforce them. So things like that, yes, I'm very worried about things like that, and I don't know exactly where that's going to go. And again, I think that this is very important for people to just speak out. It's incredibly important for people to speak out. Yeah.
My name is Don Ferguson, and I'm not an avid reader of Dr. Malthus, but based on what you've said today, the conclusion I've reached is that Malthus wins and you lose. And the question I want to ask is, what evidence have you brought to us today to support the thesis that you're making that there's sort of a bright future ahead for us? If I've understood your presentation, and I don't maintain I do, I think you've made two points. One point is that you claim that humans have the capacity to reduce their reproductive growth rates, and I agree on that. You've also said that humans have the capacity to behave more intelligently and behave in a more mutually beneficial fashion towards one another. And I agree that's also a possibility, but I suggest you bring very little in the way of either logic or facts to us. I think what you bring to us today is a matter of hope. This is the hope that you have for the future. You mentioned Julian Simon, and I was glad that you did, because perhaps everyone here doesn't know about the infantile writings of this professor of economics. I suggest to you that the philosophy of the Julian Simons of the world is more influential than the kind of philosophy that you and I might propound today, and perhaps you'd like to comment on that. One of the things that you've conveniently overlooked, perhaps, is the rate of food production as it relates per capita person on the planet. The days of the Green Revolution are far behind us. Since 1960, if you look at the per capita production of foods, and you take fish, you take grains, and so on, that graph is steadily going down.
That's
and
right.
You
yeah.
nod in affirmation, so you're aware of that.
Yeah. Yeah.
All these things suggest that Malthus was on the right track, despite perhaps some of his religious difficulties. And I would like you to respond in terms of more factual evidence that your hope for the future is the one that we should look forward to.
Well, I'm trying to do a little bit more than just offer a hope. I mean, it's pretty useless to just stand up and sort of say, well, I hope we can, you know, that we'll behave more intelligently. Again, specifically, the focus of my argument was the claim that Malthus made that an overpopulation crisis is inevitable. That's the focus of my argument. And he trotted out a sort of pseudo-scientific argument to attempt to support this. And it's a very dubious argument for the reasons that I outlined. However, again, as I said in my talk, I don't deny that Malthusian crises do occur to human beings. They have occurred a number of times in history, particularly on isolated systems like Easter Island, where the issues become extremely acute. There's no question that these things can happen. There's no question that I think we're looking at one in the face now, that we are living in pretty dangerous times. I don't deny that for a moment. And I sure don't have any pat solutions. I don't have a little formula like Julian Simon does. I agree with you that Simon is fatuous and irresponsible. But the issue is you've got to get clear on what your set of options are. The kind of thing that I'm talking about is not impossible. I'm not sure how likely it is that we can turn it around in time, but it's not impossible, and that was my primary point. And now, if you want to take a really hard look at the situation in the world today, with 6 billion plus very hungry people, as you say, per capita food production on a slide, oil is about to run, certainly going to run out, and don't you think that the people in Edmonton don't know that? That, incidentally, is my paranoid view. I watch X-Files, by the way, so I'm a bit paranoid, but my paranoid interpretation is that the present situation in Alberta can be explained by the fact that the oil companies would desire to get as much profit out of the oil revenues while it still lasts, and if alternative energy sources come online too soon, then the maximum profitability of that oil will be, of course, cut into. Well, anyway, that's just my paranoia acting up, but and it still doesn't address the issue. Yeah, you can be very, very pessimistic if you want. You can look, essentially, you can look at the current trends. I mean, I never even talked about nuclear war, all right? Many, many countries have nuclear capability now. If you can steal some plutonium somewhere, you can actually build a nuclear bomb for about $100,000. If you have a good machine shop, you can build a fairly crude nuclear device if you can steal a bit of plutonium. And there's kilograms upon kilograms of plutonium that are missing, simply missing, in inventories around the world. So yeah, I haven't even talked about that. So it would have been very possible for me to wax pessimistic here. Nuclear war, HIV... the threat of an influenza outbreak, declining food productions, the petering out fossil fuel stocks, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But what I'm simply trying to do is point out that there are other possibilities. Now, it's a very difficult judgment call as to how lively those possibilities are. I mean, perhaps the alternative is just be a survivalist, go up into the mountains, build yourself a bomb shelter put by 100-pound bags of beans and wait. Some people do that, and maybe they'll be the ones to pull through. I don't know. I'm not quite ready to give up yet. I guess there's to some degree this is sort of a philosophical position: is the glass half full or half empty? And maybe I'm sort of the type of guy who says that it's still half full. I don't know if that really answers your question or not. I can't. In terms of do I have facts to support my position? Well, as I say, I can point to the general facts of biology, that the sort of patterns that Malthus talked about are not the only possible population dynamics across a broad range of organisms, from bacteria all the way up to the higher mammals. That he just was wrong in describing this as the only possible population dynamic. I can point to specific instances where human populations have been more or less symbiotic to a greater or less degree with their environments. I can point to various, for example, let's talk about soils, something I have a tiny bit of familiarity with, although not to prairie soils, but in other parts of Canada, I have seen, for example, people will say topsoil, it takes 10,000 years to produce an inch of topsoil. This is just false. If you know what you're doing, you can turn a gravel pit into 2 feet of potting soil in a couple of years. I've seen it done. I've had it in my hands. I know that it can be done, right? It requires a certain amount of know-how and ingenuity, and you got to spend a little money, of course, heaven forbid. But yes, you can do it, right? So, no, I can't prove that it's going to be wonderful. As a matter of fact, I think that we're in an extremely risky situation right now. But what I can give you at least some probable grounds for thinking that it's not necessarily hopeless. And that was my real claim.
I'm Howard Forsyth. I'm close enough to 100 that I expect to live beyond 100, but I won't live till 2050. I'm pretty well convinced that 2050 is a pretty disastrous time. I'm pressing the same question as Don asked. Surely, with all the thinking you've been doing about it, aside from nuclear war and HIV and influenza and all these special things, what's your most likely thought of what kind of procedural things might work, like educating the rest of the world, getting women educated so they don't get caught with having so many babies, technology for the third world, these kind of slow processes, even convincing people in the developed world where their pressure on resources is 7 or 8 times as high as the third world. What ordinary procedural things that seem likely, aside from the big disasters, that might save us from disaster in 2050?
Well, again, I wish I could give you a lovely prescription. I think communication, I think education. These, of course, are my field. That's what I do for a living, so naturally that's what I think of first, and that's what I put most of my efforts into. Because you can exert a tremendous amount of leverage, if you like, if you want to use that phrase, with a well-placed word, a well-written article, an insightful book, just at the right time and at the right place, can really make thousands of people think a little bit differently. And there, too, you're appealing to the best within people, too. You're appealing to people's compassion and to people's reason. So that's, for me, what I would want to work on is just, how should we put it, spreading the word, opening people's eyes to possibilities, trying to make them think. Don't give up so soon. It's very easy to fall into cynicism and anger and despair when you look at the situation. And I suppose if I were on the Titanic, I would have been bailing right to the last. You know, I guess that's maybe just my psychological makeup, but, you know, maybe if we just all bail a little harder, you know, but No, I wish I don't have a simple recipe, and I think one of the big problems is how do you bring it home at the political level when we presently have governments that are so committed to business first before everything else. And I'm not against business, but that would be very foolish, but I would like to suggest to you that business isn't the only thing in the world. I hope that's not too radical for some people. Anyway, again, I haven't really answered your question. My primary function and what I try to do as an educator and as a writer is open people's minds to possibilities so that people go, oh, gee, I never thought of that before. I haven't got the answer. I'm trying to suggest possible avenues of exploration.
Terry Shellington, I've appreciated your presentation. It's quite refreshing. I don't have a question. I have a couple of observations. One of them is, after listening to you hammer away at Reverend Malthus for the last hour, I think it's a pretty awful day to be a reverend. I think.
Well, I'm kind of irreverent. Well, whatever.
People of that ilk clearly ought to be put off in a holding tank somewhere. Second observation is that I guess Malthus subscribed to the doomsday scenario, you know, that things are going to get worse and worse, and I hear you challenging that, and a lot of preachers have made a lot of mileage on raising the problems and the fears, and I think media do too, and our whole culture often thrives on the bad news rather than the good news, and I hear you just raising up the specter that, well, gee, maybe we ought to focus on life-giving solutions rather than doomsday possibilities.
Amen, and brother, if I may.
Hallelujah.
Well, but maybe just a very brief comment in this whole question of sort of the millennial issues. Obviously, this kind of doomsaying does tend to increase donations. But also I think there's a kind of a psychological feeling. If it's a great, I've read accounts of when war was declared, for example, in World War I in Europe, people were overjoyed. They weren't overjoyed 3 or 4 years later, but the day the war was declared, they were singing in the street, right? And there's a kind of a schools out feeling that I think people have when they anticipate, oh boy, the world's about to blow up. You know, that's great. You know, it's sort of like Calvin and Hobbes, who is thrilled when an ice age nearly wipes out his little town. You know, that's fun. But the thing is, let's grow up. You know, let's grow up. That we're looking for solutions to come down out of the sky. We're looking for great, spectacular miracles of some sort. I'm sorry, but it's just going to be a lot of people doing a lot of little things as well as they can. That's over quite a period of time. That's how it's going to be solved. It's relatively few miracles. Miracles, I suppose, can happen, but you sure don't put your money on them.
Listening to you, I'm mindful of a quote I read once. I can't recall who said it, so I can't credit that, but it's, when on the edge of a precipice, progress may be in taking a step backwards. And just in some of my travels, in the world, I've become aware of examples of cultures that have survived for thousands or tens of thousands of years in pretty much sustainably with their environment. And I'm wondering if there's not some lessons that we can learn by stepping back and looking at the worldview of some of these peoples. And acknowledging that there might have been folks who addressed these issues before us and came to an understanding of how to deal with it. I think the problem we're up against now is largely a result of European colonization of the world. And that was a really rapid event, and we've only been here on the North American continent about 100 or so years. And this could just be a big blip in the whole history of mankind. And I'd just like some of your comments on that, and specifically to know if you have looked at other cultures and worldviews about this issue.
Sure. Okay, well, two comments. First of all, let me just take the second point first, because I think there's a common misunderstanding there. I have looked a little bit into the history of environmental problems throughout basically as much of human history as we presently know about, and there's a lot of literature on this. And European cultures are by no means the only culprits. people have been engineering environmental disasters for thousands of years. I mentioned Easter Island as a typical example. You look through the, Asia, for example. There's lots of examples in Asia, and there are. It is certainly the present phase of it has obviously. I mean, I don't want to insult anybody's intelligence. Obviously, has enormously powerful European component to it. But it, to me, it's fundamentally a human problem, not necessarily a European problem, a problem of the industrial age, etc. These are just the manifestations that the problem takes in our time. Now, as to the question about other cultures, yes, I don't think there's any question that we have a lot to learn from many other cultures in the world. I mentioned briefly during my talk the Kayapo peoples of Brasilia. A lot of people didn't realize, I didn't realize this until I did some reading on it, is that there's large sections of the Amazon rainforest that actually, I mean, we think of this as archetypically wilderness, archetypically something unspoiled, untouched by human hands. It's simply false. That this large regions of that territory, I mean, it's all being destroyed now, of course, but were until recently simply sort of very large, highly elaborate gardens maintained by the people who had lived there for a good many thousand years. And by processes of shifting agriculture, very selective planting, selective cutting, highly skilled burning techniques and soil cultivation techniques and so forth, they just sort of kept that rainforest in a sort of a pruned state, which was able to provide them with considerable, you know, the necessities of life. And again, there is some evidence, ecologists can bicker about this, there's some evidence it actually increased the biodiversity, actually increased the total vitality of that ecosystem. And so that's just an example. So yes, I think we have a lot to learn from cultures that have had some degree of success, and even cultures with relatively low technology. I think one of the big issues now, and I think a huge unsolved question, is how is it possible to do something like what they did on the scale, the technological scale that we exist now? And many environmentalists will argue we have to go back to primitive technology again. And I have some doubts about that. To go back, I mentioned very briefly that there was I was familiar with a case in which some very eroded topsoil was turned back into this very, very rich land again. Now, what was quite essential to that process was heavy machinery. You need powerful tractor, you need an offset disc, you need a chisel plow, hydraulic takeoff, all this kind of thing. With these tools, you can do things that would be close to physically impossible with hand tools and animal-powered tools. And so the technology, to me, is not necessarily a bad thing. Again, here we're back to this question of what is necessarily the case. And I'm always taking the role of saying things are less necessary than you think. There's more possibilities than you think. I mean, we can destroy the world with technology, but I've seen technology put to very good use as well. So the question to me would be, could we integrate the wisdom of some of these other cultures with our capabilities today? Now, there's a really interesting challenge. Yeah.
I really enjoyed your talk, and I would agree with everything you say, but having lived at the receiving end of bombs, at the receiving end of genocide, I have very little hope about birth control. In fact, I don't think that birth control is the prime, the priority at the moment. The priority would be to do away with weapons production, with the sale of weapons by every country, including Canada, to whoever is the highest bidder and wants it. There would never have been a war with Iraq if the United States, North America, Europe hadn't given Hussein the weapons to fight Iran. There wouldn't be wars in the Middle East, in the Far East, and in Africa if everybody wasn't so keen to sell them weapons. We have bazaars in Canada, I think they're annual now, where the whole world comes in to buy modern weapons. Now, this is something, if there was enough of an outcry how many of you know, or do you know, where our weapons factories are, who owns them, what influence they have on our government? Why can't there be an outcry before birth control to get the government to outlaw any sales of weapons to other countries.
Okay, that's a really good set of issues, and okay, I don't know the figures for Canada. I know it's a major issue in industry in Canada, although the government doesn't like to sort of trumpet that fact. I do know that worldwide is the typical figure that one hears. If you sort of totted up the armaments sales worldwide, they're in the order of $1 trillion per year. That's $1,000 billion per year, and it goes without saying that could build a lot of hospitals, that could plant a lot of trees, build a lot of schools, et cetera, et cetera. That's quite obvious. And yeah, I totally agree with you that that's a huge problem. On the question of how this bears on birth control, I think I could have said more about the following issue. Many approaches to birth control, particularly in what we condescendingly call third world countries, have tended to have a rather coercive nature about them. India's failed birth control policy of a few decades ago was a classic example. You know how that went. If a family had a third child, then the father was required by law, sort of at gunpoint essentially, to undergo a vasectomy. And to say that this was politically unpopular is an understatement. I think coercive approaches to moderating the birth side of the equation are not going to work very well. I think they're counterproductive. I would like to see people do what they will do by choice. What I'd like to see is people, particularly women, say, okay, I could have 3 kids if I want, I could have 8 kids if I want, but let them make the choice and give them the options. And for that, they have to have the knowledge and they have to have basic facilities to make those choices. The ideal situation would be one in which we all just sort of figure this all out and then just all agree to do it. And I'm not sure how likely that is to happen. That's a very good question. I don't know if I've really answered your question. Yes, but certainly I agree that the arms issue is a hugely important issue. $1 trillion being squandered on love. I mean, it's great when the B-1B comes to the air show. You know, they have them here. So that's a really cool airplane. But you know what that one of those airplanes cost? Depending on how I've seen estimates ranging from several hundred million to $2 billion per aircraft. Per aircraft. In other words, that would put a new hospital in every community in Canada to buy one of those aircraft. Right. So yeah, there's a lot of waste on military expenditure right now.
I don't see any more questions. And John, we missed you today. Do you have time? I think we have about 2 minutes, John, real fast.
John Boris, you know, I would just like to say you're a breath of fresh air. I think even the religious people have to admit that where it's brimstone and fire and fury, that raises money. And if you can scare the pants off of people, you'll get the money. And you were saying it's done by coercion so often. You know, Nobel Prize is now a good thing. And how did the guy make his money? Inventing dynamite. Rhodes Scholarship. Terrific, especially if you're British. How'd he make the money? By having a monopoly on gold in South Africa. And you can go all over. In Alberta, we're now going to gamble. We're not worried about losing our oil. We're going to get more money, not by coercion, but merely by putting VLTs in places. Because nobody is coerced into that. They do it voluntarily. So I think it's a matter of education, as you say, and we have to convince people that they can't use just their own interest, like you alluded that even Malthus did, and I think that a lot of these people are doing the same thing. Any comment?